Dark Cast Network. Out of the shadows comes the best in indie podcasts. I'm Jen of Our True Crime Podcast, and you're listening to Beyond the Rainbow, True Crimes of the LGBTQ+.
Hey, use of pornographic language may occur. Pornographic language? Does that mean I'll be moaning throughout the cases? Yeah, probably not. Hey there, Rainbow Warriors, and welcome to Beyond the Rainbow, True Crimes of the LGBTQ+. I'm your host who likes peanut butter toast, CJ. Holy shit cakes, Warriors! We're already in October. That's just insane to me. I know I spent a good portion of this year in a depression funk, and thankfully it's starting to dissipate. Jack has taken away many of my tears, even though I still miss my little baby Nilla, and I still talk to her several times a day, but at least I'm no longer crying several times a day. So there's that, and after standing up for myself with the kids, my living situation has improved drastically. Hell, I've even been playing Call of Duty with my daughter's boyfriend. So yay! I hope your mental health is good too, Warriors. If it's not and it's something you need to talk to someone about, I'm here for you. Just remember that. This month is Domestic Violence Awareness Month, and I thought it was important to cover some LGBTQ+ cases of domestic violence in order to honor survivors and those who were not so fortunate to survive their attacker. With that, let's start out with the story of survivor Patrick Doughty. Patrick is the author of the book, I Am Me, Survivor of Child Abuse and Bullying Speaks Out. Patrick was the youngest of five kids growing up in the Chicago, Illinois area. At the age of 9 in 1972, he would be raped by a man in his local Sears department store bathroom. Patrick's best friend's mom told the boys never to go anywhere alone, including bathrooms. Always make sure a father or an older brother was with them. Patrick found out she was right. As Patrick was in the bathroom alone in the department store, a grown man came in, locked the bathroom door, and raped Patrick. He then held a knife to the boy's throat, threatening to kill him and his family if he ever said anything to anyone. 7 years later, that man was arrested for killing and raping at least 33 boys. His name? John Wayne Gacy. Patrick knew when he saw the man on the news, serial killer and rapist John Wayne Gacy. He was certain that was the man who attacked him 7 years prior in the public bathroom. Patrick was never quite the same after that tragic attack when he was only 9. He was ashamed. It was a taboo subject he could never tell anyone about, let alone discuss his feelings of anger, fear, and confusion. Plus, at that age and time era, Patrick didn't even know the word rape. He couldn't find the right words to communicate his harrowing ordeal. Patrick had previously been a straight-A student, but he ended up failing the third grade that year as a result of John Wayne Gacy's pedophilic acts. While Patrick was trying to quietly process his rape over the years, his older brother Marco had become physically abusive towards Patrick as well. At age 7, Marco split Patrick's lip open. This injury required stitches. Then, when Patrick was 10, Marco cracked Patrick's head open. Again, more stitches. And there were plenty of other instances which did not require medical attention. This almost reminds me of the chicken effect. You know, where one chicken is wounded or weaker than the others, so the stronger chickens in the coop will pick on the weaker chicken until all the chickens are picking on the weak one. Nonetheless, Patrick grew up, carrying scars from his childhood with him. He married women twice. Both his first and his second wife were verbally and emotionally abusive towards him. And trust me, Emotional and verbal abuse are just as bad as physical abuse, if not sometimes worse, as they can make you feel extremely bad about yourself, like you don't matter. And by now, we should all know we matter. We cannot give anyone that kind of power over us. After that second marriage ended, Patrick then entered into a relationship with a man. This male partner was physically and financially abusive to him. Patrick acquired another boyfriend, and unfortunately, that relationship became physically abusive as well. It ended after Patrick's boyfriend pushed him down a flight of stairs, breaking Patrick's arm in several places. It almost seemed like Patrick was a magnet for these abusive people. But what I do love about Patrick is that he's always been willing to open himself up again to love. The prior pain he suffered in his life, it's still there. But he never seems to build huge walls to keep everyone else out because of his fear of being hurt. That really is not something that's easy to do, and I commend him for that. Patrick was also wise enough to seek out some therapy for his mental wellness. One of his therapists, after Patrick told him about his initial abuses, told Patrick, "That's very common, actually. Many people are attracted to individuals with their own issues, and they feel like they can help cure that other person, but of course they can't." Therapy was good for Patrick, and a friend of his even persuaded him to write a book, which Patrick did. It was all very therapeutic, and Patrick was eventually able to see that he deserved better. He deserved more than the abusive relationships. The next case is also about a survivor, but this survivor turns into a killer. It was the early morning hours of January 31st, 1995. Patricia Phillips had recently turned 25 years old. She was lying in a puddle of her own blood in a parking lot outside of a nightclub on the west side of Chicago, Illinois. Patricia was fighting to stay alive. She had been run over several times with a big old Cadillac, but all attempts to save Patricia were futile and she died at the scene. The driver of the car was Patricia's girlfriend, Willette Benford. Willette had been afraid to leave Patricia, as Patricia had often threatened that she would kill Willette and then herself. But that night in January, Willette had borrowed her mother's Cadillac, and she drove both Patricia and herself to the nightclub. Around 2:30 a.m., the couple were on the dance floor, and they started to verbally fight. Willette in her head was saying, "Fuck this," and video footage shows Willette with her car keys in her hand. She's heading out to the parking lot. She reached her mom's car, opened the car door, and got inside. She started the vehicle, and Patricia came running outside and jumped on the hood of the car. Willette was just desperate to escape her partner's anger. She pulled away, and Patricia rolled off the car. Willette turned the car around to see if Patricia was all right, and that's when Willette ran over something. She was pretty sure it was just a pothole. When more people came out of the nightclub, Willette put the car back in drive and took off, again hitting the pothole. Only it wasn't a pothole, it was Patricia. It didn't take long for the Chicago police to find and apprehend Willette. Once she was arrested, she was charged with first-degree murder for the death of Patricia Phillips. Next would be her court trial. Willette's defense attorney did not want her saying that Patricia was her girlfriend. Still living a surreal type existence, Willette went with whatever her defense wanted, and as far as the court was concerned, Willette and Patricia were simply friends. This took the domestic abuse card off the table for Willette. But the defense was afraid being a black woman in a lesbian relationship would be too much for the jury to handle. Apparently, in 1995 Chicago wasn't too accepting of the LGBTQ. Truthfully, the defense was just a chicken shit, and it might have fared better for Willette had she been able to claim the domestic abuse. Her jury found her guilty, and a judge sentenced Willette to 50 years of incarceration. Although Willette would have decades shaved off her prison sentence. A law passed in 2016 that changed how people in Illinois should look at domestic abuse victims and their sentences. Once that occurred, and Willette was able to appeal her case, she won. The new law was a second chance for Willette, a second chance to tell about her domestic abuse where she was silenced by her defense attorney the first time around. On February 6, 2018, after 23 years incarcerated, Willette walked out of the prison a free woman. The saddest part for her was all the time she missed while she was in prison. Her son was 2 years old at the time she was convicted, and she missed out on almost all of his firsts. But there were some bright spots that came after she was released. She was appointed by the mayor of Chicago as the new director of a reentry program which helps the incarcerated and formerly incarcerated prepare to reenter life in the city of Chicago. It assists with legal aid, finding housing, and employment. So I guess good for Willette. 15-year-old non-binary River Nevaeh Goddard went missing 2 years ago in 2022 from Rhode Island. River's preferred pronouns were she and they. She was in a relationship with a 20-year-old man named Shane Curry. It would seem that Shane struggles with mental health issues. Loved ones searched for River for those 2 years. River had been living with Shane at his home in Stowe, Massachusetts. On April 5th of this year, the now 17-year-old River was found dead in Shane's home. Shane had accused River of cheating on him. He accused River of drug use, and Shane would physically abuse River every time he got mad at her. Shane had told the local news station, "The bruises aren't working. Hitting her, that's not working. So, okay, I have to knife her, so I do." Shane had stabbed River to death multiple times using a sword. In 2020, Shane had been diagnosed with schizophrenia. At his court arraignment, he pleaded not guilty due to his mental diagnosis, although he had already admitted to stabbing River. River's grandfather said that River had a tough childhood, growing up in Rhode Island's foster care system. He said he had spoken over the phone to Shane, and Shane promised to take care of River. But Shane was still a child himself at 18 when 15-year-old River came to live with him. And since his mental health wasn't in check, he had troubles taking care of himself, let alone another child. It's truly scary when relationships go from hitting and pushing to murder. They escalate because the perpetrator gets away with it once, then twice, and so on. I believe it's important that we raise our children with the knowledge they need to set boundaries within their relationships. If they're in a relationship and their partner ever gets physical, that's it. End it. Otherwise, it'll potentially get worse. I remember telling guys I was with in my teen years, "If you ever hit me, I'm gone." I set my boundaries early just so they knew. Because of his mental health issues, Shane most likely won't be considered competent to stand trial anytime soon for River's murder. Rest in power, River. The last case I have for you, I'm not 100% sure if the folks involved are LGBTQ+, but I do believe that the main male perpetrator is bisexual. John Michael Sisko grew up in an abusive household in Halifax, Nova Scotia. This is a settlement in Canada. He was only 3 pounds 9 ounces at birth due to fetal malnutrition. His birth mother rejected him and didn't give him the warmth and love a mother should give their child. As a toddler, she trapped him in an overturned playpen. It was a makeshift cage so he couldn't go exploring. By age 3 and a half, he was in the foster care system, and he was being whipped and beaten by one of his foster fathers. A doctor who examined John after one such beating noted in John's medical records that he would most likely suffer from emotional damage due to the beatings. Eventually, John was adopted by a couple in Montreal, but John could barely walk and he could only say 2 words. He was definitely delayed in speech and delayed with his fine and large motor skills. His adoptive parents spent months breaking him of the habit of searching garbage cans to find food. They just wanted to give him everything he had been missing in life. But as a child, John showed very little emotion. He did have a hatred for women, however, and it was probably the only emotion he displayed. By now, his adoptive parents complained to the foster agency John had come from. They were not given enough background information about the child. John was now kicking and punching other kids at school, and there seemed to be no one who could control his poor behavior. In kindergarten, he was so disruptive and explosive, he was put in the special education classes the elementary school offered. John would only behave if he was under constant supervision by an adult. John was made to take extensive psychological evaluations as a young child. He was put on medication for schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and depression, as well as Ritalin for ADHD. At the age of 8, John had horrible temper tantrums. He would pee and poo all over the house, and he would pee intentionally on kids at school. He would make life threats against his adoptive parents, and they were truly in fear of John. At 9 years old, his IQ scores came back. His results were at 88, very low as an IQ score goes. And what's even worse is his score would continue to deteriorate. In 2013, when John was an adult, his IQ score was just 66. Around the age of 12, John's adoptive parents were done. They couldn't provide John with what he needed, and his behavior was erratic and chaotic. They gave him up to a group home. He continued to have vicious tantrums, and he started to steal from the other kids. John was made to give blowjobs to some of the older boys in the group home, and he continued doing this for years, even after he was moved to another group home. He started drinking alcohol at age 14 and doing drugs at 16. At 17, John left the group home and foster care system for good. As an adult, John sported a pretty nasty cocaine habit. He afforded it by dancing at a gay club for men. He also worked a criminal game with ATM fraud. Several times, John would be hospitalized for cocaine overdose. This led medical personnel to believe that John was trying to take his own life. John took a girlfriend and moved in with her in Quebec. He went searching for work, but he was frustrated that he couldn't find anything, and not knowing how to speak French didn't help matters. Out of anger and frustration, he went home, grabbed his girlfriend by her hair, and beat the shit out of her. When his anger subsided, he told her that he wanted to move to Winnipeg. He knew someone there, someone who could get him a job. He promised he would never hurt her again, and he told her not to dwell on the past. Too trusting, his girlfriend believed John's words and agreed to move with him. In Winnipeg, 1997, John's level of violence with his girlfriend escalated enormously. He would beat her and force her into having sex with him, essentially raping her. He once shared that he enjoyed making women feel pain.
They make us suffer, so why shouldn't we make them?
John found work at a gay bar, and he tried to force his girlfriend to work as a prostitute. She refused. Her grandfather, who helped raise her, wasn't able to get in touch with her, so he sent the police to the last known address he had for her in Winnipeg. Police found her there and removed her from the home, placing her in a safe shelter until she could be reunited with her grandfather. She told the police John was threatening to kill her and their unborn child. She was finally able to return to Quebec, where she was continually tormented with nightmares about her time with John. John was now again on his own. At 30 years old, he headed to British Columbia, where he met a 17-year-old girl and he started to woo her. She worked at a carnival, and she was in a relationship with an abusive boyfriend. John started to love bomb her with sweet notes and little stuffed animals. But John lied about who he was. He told her his name was Giovanni Papiani, and he was from Italy. She thought this man is exactly what she was looking for in a boyfriend. John got a job with the traveling carnival, too. Now they were both carnies. But John would break his hand on one of the controllers for a ride he was operating. and he lost his job. The couple would then move to Victoria, where the girl's family was. John convinced his 17-year-old girlfriend to steal checks from her mother, which she did. When they attempted to cash them, they were arrested. Once released, they fled to Vancouver, joining another traveling carnival. Crack cocaine was introduced to the girl, and the couple began to use it heavily. And John forced the girl into sex work to pay for their crack habit. Then the couple moved to Montreal. John was perceiving his girlfriend as being too flirtatious with every guy she met. He was enraged and he would beat her. He told her he was gonna kill her. The girl eventually got herself together and moved back to her family in Victoria. But the girl and John reconnected over a social network forum and they got back together. John stole a car in Winnipeg and drove the two of them to Regina. Here he was arrested for car theft, but when he was released, he was so happy to be out, he proposed to the girl and they got married. Her dress was purchased from a thrift store, a kindly priest and his wife got them rings, and their wedding dinner was at McDonald's, because John sure knew how to treat a girl. The honeymoon phase of John's new marriage was short, because he became violent again and the intensity of his violence with his now much younger wife had just gotten worse. In October of 2002, the girl became pregnant, though she wasn't sure the baby was her husband John's. She was having trouble with the pregnancy, and she had to have surgery to prevent her cervix from dilating too soon. She was not supposed to have sex during her pregnancy for fear of injuring the baby. Well, this pissed off John, and he raped her that night. Thus, the baby was born prematurely, and it only weighed 1 pound and 8 ounces. The baby did not survive. A year later, the girl divorced John, and she admitted she had been unfaithful to him. Of course, his anger led him to beat her and hold a knife to his own throat, claiming he was going to kill himself. He didn't, and she was able to escape the violent relationship. By 2009, John took another female lover who had a husband in Toronto. The husband at one time had been John's friend. Within months, John was living in their home, and he was keeping the husband as a hostage while he had sex with the husband's wife, and he forced the husband to watch. The wife went along with all of it. The husband would be tortured and sexually assaulted regularly by John. In January 19th of 2010, the police found the husband bound in his home. And it's lucky they did, as he was painfully thin. He was battered and a shell of the man he used to be. Had they not found him, he most likely would have died under the living conditions John forced him into. The husband was made to live in a tiny blood-stained closet in the home. Of course, this is when he was not being beaten or forced to watch his wife and John have sex. John and the wife were arrested and taken into custody. The wife received 8.5 years of incarceration for her part in her husband's abduction, captivity, aggravated assault, and sexual assault. John was sentenced indefinitely to prison for his violence and depravity. For years after the trial, the husband still lived in fear of John. He was afraid John would escape and finish him off. Now, I only went into John's background to paint a picture of how abusive behavior can have a domino effect on someone, especially someone who starts their life out being a victim of abuse. John's early life clearly demonstrates how a child of abuse can grow to be an adult abusive monster. Now, that's not true for every case, because there's a lot of people who were abused in their childhood who are really good people. Oh, that was a tough load of cases. And it's so important to first not allow yourself to become a victim of abuse. I know that's easier said than done. But should you be in a violent or volatile situation, or if you know someone who is, please reach out for help. The National Domestic Violence Hotline is 1-800-799-SAFE, SAFE, 7233. And remember, always, you matter. I love you, Rainbow Warriors. It's not a crime to be gay, unless you're a murderer. Or a fucked up abuser like John.